Hey, Lemmy.
Yes, Kevin.
You know what?
What?
You know what I'm going to say, right?
I think I do.
Blue Chew wants to help you have better sex. Huh?
I could use it.
Right. So you can unlock your sexuality at BlueChew.com. Chew it and do it.
See, Kevin has already been a subscriber to BlueChew.com, which is why he's like flirting
with
me.
Sure, I can feel it, right? I can feel
it's coursing through your through your vein. Listen, we got a special deal for our listeners. You go to BlueChew.com, enter the promo code TALKOMA, that's T-A-L-K-O-M-A, and you get the first month free. Okay, all you have to do is pay $5 for shipping and handling. Okay,
but it's BlueChew.com.
Promo code TALKOMA, T-A-L-K-O-M-A.
And hey, Blue Chew, thanks for sponsoring our podcast.
Welcome to another episode of TALKOMA FD. TALKOMA FD.
Wow, that's really good. You should be a pitch man.
You like that shit?
Yeah, that's really good.
You like that? I'm in an excellent mood.
You should be a salesman.
I'm in an excellent mood.
Why?
You know what? Because I had a silly beginning to my day.
Today?
Today.
Yeah.
Today.
What happened?
Today.
What happened?
Today. I got in the shower.
Yeah.
And it was one of those ones where, like, you go to get out of the shower and you realize you forgot to bring the towel over.
Sure. So you're dripping. Yeah.
And there's, you know, there's the mat.
Right.
And so, but you have to get on the mat. You don't want to get the floor wet. And so you shuffle across with the mat.
Okay.
And it's like,
okay, I'm scared for you. Yes.
No, but that's, okay. It's like, it's silly. Then I look over at myself in the mirror and I can see myself.
You're doing a little mat shuffle.
Doing the mat shuffle across before I get my towel. I'm laughing about it.
All right.
And it's like, you know, I think you need things like that to start off your day properly.
Put you in a good mood.
Because it's like.
It's absurd.
Well, the last time I had a little.
Absurd.
It's the absurdities of life. You know, last time I had a moment like this was when I had a leak in my house.
Yes.
And I came racing down the stairs.
Very traumatic situation, right? You had a leak in your house. You woke up to go to the bathroom late at night, not knowing there was a leak. Yeah,
5:30 in the morning.
Yeah.
And I went downstairs because that's where the bidet is.
Yeah, okay.
And the way my house works is there's a couple of steps down.
Yeah.
Into that area of the house. And I took the first step and then the second step and I stepped into 3 inches of water.
Oh, man. Shit water?
And shit water. And I wiped out.
Yeah.
And landed on my back. Luckily, I didn't hit my head on one of the stairs, but like, that's the alternative to this.
Oh, yeah.
This is a fun way to wake up. That was a very unpleasant.
Yeah. And we're old. We shouldn't be falling down.
Because it could be our last
fall. The older you get, the more traumatic the fall is.
You could break a hip.
Sure.
You could break a shoulder.
Yeah, you could land in shit water. You could
break a fucking microphone. Get the fuck up here. Anyway, so yeah, so that's, you know, those are two different ways to start your day.
Okay.
One's unpleasant and one's silly and nice.
I'm glad you find the joy in things like that.
I do. I take time to smell the roses, Kev.
That's great. Hey, I wore my hot dog shirt today.
That's great.
Should I reference this?
Yeah, what is the hot dog
shirt? This is our grip crew, which is started by my brother, Pat Heffernan. Wait, should I show the, can you see this?
Yeah, 1 pound long. I don't even know what that means.
I don't know. It's like a Dragon Grips. That's the Grip Crew. And this was their t-shirt they made for everybody in the last season of Tacoma. And so, did you get one of these?
Yeah.
So this is the Grip Crew, 1 pound long. I don't know.
And so
it's
what,
something are, sexual, I think. I
are know. They like paying us to advertise? Like, are they?
No, getting, no, no. I wear
they,
the shirt.
Are they selling merch now or something?
No, I wear the shirt around my house and it makes my wife uncomfortable because she thinks there's something sexual about the shirt.
Right.
But I don't, I mean, I assume there
is. Well, there is because it's your brother. And grips, as we know, traditionally are juvenile.
Yeah, they are.
You know, they have immature senses of humor.
They do. You're right.
But listen, you know, this is Tacoma FD. It's not the Shakespeare, you know what
I'm
saying?
Sure, yeah. So. We make dick jokes.
Speaking of.
Yeah, episode 405.
Woo!
The death photo.
Yeah, I do. Right? I just want to also, before we get into it.
Yeah.
Last episode, I incorrectly said that John Cougar Mellencamp said small town 17 times.
Okay.
In his song Small Town.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard the song Small Town by John Cougar Mellencamp?
Many times.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know how many times he said the word small town in that song?
A lot.
17.
Is that right?
Yeah. 17 times.
How do you know that?
I just know things, bro.
Okay.
Well, 17 times. You know, everybody here was clamoring, like, it's 18. We looked it up on Google.
Is that true?
And I went home and listened to it, and sure enough, it's 18. So
I guess something said that. Who fucking cares?
I was wrong.
Who cares how many times he says it?
I was wrong. Well, it's cool. He says it exactly 18 times. It's
a
cool
thing. Is 18 a significant number?
No. But like when you're-
So what does it fucking matter?
When you're like,
what if I said he says it 23 times?
Because here's what happens. Like when you're in a bar and somebody happens to be talking about John Cougar Mellencamp, small town, you're like, you know, he says it 18 times.
Okay.
And then somebody goes,
"So what?"
People listen to it, and they're like, "Oh my God, that's amazing!" I don't think people like you say, "So what?"
I don't know that it's amazing.
All right, you listen. We're not going to bicker after all this.
Okay, no, okay, all right, it's fine.
Okay,
death photo. So this episode, one of the things I like about this is when you take like something in from that everyone can relate to in real life, and then find the firefighter version of it, which was what we did here.
Yeah,
like because we were sitting around the writers' room. Talking about things that we shared growing up. And one of them was the yearly school photo.
Yes.
Right? And how funny it was. And people told the stories about it. And it was, you know, do firefighters have something like that?
Right.
And then we talked to Cousin Bill. And he told us that they do, in fact, that they take a picture every year, maybe or every few years, and they wear their dress uniforms.
Yeah.
And these pictures are called the death photos because these are the photos that they will use if you die on the job.
Correct.
This will be the photo that's in the paper. This will be your obituary picture. And so they call them death photos. And so there's like a kind of like funny, morbid
Well, also
situation.
Because a lot of guys, you find out the hard way without really finding out because you're dead.
Yes.
And so, but everybody else is laughing at your all-time photo.
Right.
Because that photo also tends to be at the funeral.
It's your firefighter photo. It's in the newspaper. It's, you know, it's wherever.
Yeah.
And so.
It's like a driver's license photo.
Yeah. And so there's this desire or, you know, firefighters are tough guys and they don't like to, you know, I think they don't like to show vanity or like, who gives a shit, you know, but deep down inside.
Right.
You want to make sure that that photo is good.
Well, like, for instance, in a few episodes, we're going to have the funeral episode.
Yeah.
And Cousin Bill plays our dead firefighter.
Right.
And even getting him, and we actually shot him while we were shooting these photos. We had our photographer, Rich Marchuka, take the photos that we were going to use for Bill in that episode.
His death photo.
His death photo. Right. And we had him smiling, and I found it funny because, like, he didn't really want to smile too much. And I was like,
firefighters.
Don't be embarrassed, Bill. Just smile. And he, you know, gave me a hat. So I'm like, come on, Bill, let's see some teeth. And then he would exaggerate it like a little kid. You're like, it's not a prank here. Let's just do a nice smile. But it's like, there's a hardened firefighter who doesn't want to show any emotion.
Yet they want to look, I mean, nobody wants to look shitty. You know what I mean?
Right. But you've met some firefighters and things like this. They'll be like, I don't care.
Yeah.
That's namby-pamby. And you're like, it's not. It's just a photo. Just smile, you know?
Sure. There's an element of like, I don't give a shit, which is what this episode's about. That everyone has their vanities, but nobody likes to, you know, to talk about them out loud. But they show them and whatever. And, you know, it was the same way, I think, growing up, you know, when we did those high school or the school photos, right? You didn't want to show a big deal. Your mom would make a big deal out of it. And, you know, she tried to do your hair or put you in a certain outfit. You're like, Mom, I don't want to. And then the picture would come out and you'd always be upset about it or whatever it was, you know. And it was always kind of a funny yearly thing. And for my kids, it's the same way. You get your kid photos now and there's the stiff smiles and there's the, you know, like, you know, these things.
My kids don't know how to smile.
Yeah. People don't know how to do it on command.
It's absurd. It's absurd.
It's absurd. But I went back and I found one of mine, which.
I don't believe you take a bad picture, Kevin.
Well, you'd be surprised because when you're, you know, 9 years old or whatever it is. No, this photo has never been seen in public before. So I want to lower the expectations.
Well, I mean, listen, it's, you know. Oh, boy.
Yeah, there you go. Hey.
Boy, that's you, huh?
Look at that guy, huh? It's like the kid from Goonies.
That's like, I think that's the last time I saw you smile. Look at that. Is that the last? No, you're smiling right now.
Look at those fucked up teeth, though, man.
Where are your teeth, bro?
That's got to be like in between, like you've lost some and you're gaining some back again.
The thing is, that's the only haircut you've ever had in your life, too.
You think?
Yeah, well, now you cut it short. But like, you know, so like people.
That's a fucking bowl haircut is what that is, man. Come on. It's kind of a bowl haircut.
It's not kind of a bowl haircut. It's a bowl haircut.
And then I think that was my cowboy shirt.
That looks like one of those leather football helmets on your head.
On top of the head?
Yeah.
I don't know. Cute kid or no? I don't know.
Adorable.
I don't know.
Adorable.
I have better ones, I mean, where I look better. But that's one of those. That's a traditionally one where like, holy shit, look at this guy.
They're all terrible. I have one in seventh grade. I was trying to experiment with the side smile.
Yeah.
I think I...
What's that? What's a side smile? Do it in there, in that camera.
It was like... You know, like... because when I grew up, like, at that age, that was the early 80s, late 70s, was like... You had your rakish actors on, like, the Love Boat and Fantasy Island. Those were guys, like, you know, like...
Yeah.
Even, like, cigarette ads were, like...
Yeah.
You know, and so I was like, I'm going to adapt the side smile.
I'm going to be a side smile guy?
And I tried it for one of my class pictures. For the classroom shot, not my individual picture. And it's okay. It's terrible. And also I had when I was 10, my father, the night before, you know, he wanted to experiment. My dad got into hair cutting.
Really?
He got into barbering.
What does that mean?
Yeah. It was a hobby, like collecting stamps.
Really?
He was like, I want to learn how to cut hair. My father's from Argentina. He said, I want to learn how to cut hair.
Okay, so you were his guinea pig?
Yeah. And so he got the regular scissors, and then there are the scissors with like the
serrated scissors were there?
The teeth in them?
Yeah.
And it's the fucking worst haircut. And it's my fifth grade class photo. And like.
And he did it the night before?
I looked like Sprout from the Jolly Green Giant, you know, like really short here on the sides and then like hair sticking out. It was kind of an inspiration for the character I played in Quasi.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did he cut your sister's hair?
No, he did not cut my sister's hair.
Because why? Because she wouldn't let him or your mom wouldn't let him?
No one would let him.
Your mom say, don't cut their hair?
Yeah, in Spanish. No se cortaba el pelo, Carlos. No. No corta el pelo. But he did it the night before the picture was taken and all the kids made fun of me. And it's, you know, a legendary, terrible picture.
Didn't he put like... Oh, you guys do that now. You put like a cologne in your kids' hairs and stuff like that?
Yeah.
Do you do that now?
Violetas, yeah.
What is it called?
Violetas.
What does that mean?
Well, that means violets.
Violets, okay.
But it's very, you know, so my son is obviously now with my wife. He's got Cuban blood, Argentinian, Puerto Rican.
Sure.
And my wife likes to, you know, when she comes here in the morning, she puts a little violetas in both boys' hair.
Yeah.
And
what's it? It's like a
cologne
gel or something.
Cologne for kids.
Okay, but cologne for kids.
Yeah.
But what does it do to your hair? Is it like a mat it down or what does it do?
Well, first of all, it's like, you know, when you go to the barber and they don't wash your hair. Like, you've probably never been to a salon where they wash your hair first.
Nah, fuck
they
that shit.
They probably just spray
bro.
Your hair.
Just give me a cut.
Yeah. What do you?
Just give me a cut.
Yeah, what you do you guys. Want? A tree or a two?
Yeah. Just give me a three. Would you like any gel? Nah. Yeah. Thanks. I'm going to put my hat on when I'm done.
Gel's for namby-pamby.
That's the ultimate insult, I feel like, for the barber when you stand up from the chair and put your hat on and then walk out.
Yeah, but they should be
like,
used to
this is
that.
My work.
They should be used to Why? Because all barbers
mine
are
used to it now because I fucking read the newspaper and, you know.
Yeah.
I don't get involved in the haircut.
No, you've never said one word.
No.
You actually are the kind of person, you just go sit down in the barber chair and they know what to do.
Yeah.
They're like,
cut it.
Yeah, that's the two.
But anyway, so we wanted to do the episode about that. It's a lot about vanity. It's, you know, Lucy doesn't want to say it, but she's getting her hair done. Gabe doesn't want to say it, but he's getting his makeup on, you know. Marcus is getting his lighting, and you are getting whatever you get, your Botox.
I don't need to get anything, but that's the thing. It's like you always accuse me of having that false bravado. Like, I'll say one thing and do something else. You know, where I'm like, don't worry, I don't need any makeup.
Yeah.
But meanwhile, I'm back there with the fucking makeup. And people are like, wait, so you clean up pretty well. I'm like, what are you going to do? I'm, you know, I get a lot of sleep at night. You know?
Sure. And everyone thinks goes awry. You know, Lucy can't really get her hair done the way she wants to. And Gabe's getting his makeup done by a, you know,
which is
mortuary makeup artist.
Yeah. I have found this. Now, this is namby-pamby actors. This is why firefighters are like, this is why I don't like to.
Yeah.
But like. They always tend to lighten us up.
Yes.
And we're like, I'm like.
Pale.
Make me tan.
Yeah. Remember we went at one place where they like connected our eyebrows or like they made them really dark. And you're like, what the fuck are you doing? Like eyebrows. Eyebrows are where it's at. The eyebrows are the thing. You got to really tend to
that.
That
was when we were promoting Super Troopers 2.
Oh, right. WWE.
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 I'll just say the Searchlight publicist. It was like, it's the eyes that pop. It's the eyes that pop. You're going to want to highlight. I'm like, it's okay. And we looked like Bert and Ernie from.
Yeah, we did.
You know. From what's that show called?
Sesame Street.
Sesame Street.
Do you guys watch that growing up?
Yeah. Did they have that still? They do, you know.
For you, it was Sesame Street, though, right?
Sesame Street. But we watched a show called Sesame Street.
Yeah.
That's the way my dad said it. Yeah. What a stupid show is this? Sesame Street. Sesame Street. What is that? We watched something called Villa Alegre. You
know I remember that, sure. That was on PIX, right? Channel 11.
No, PBS.
Channel 13,
yeah. La, 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 Villa Alegre.
Villa Alegre. Viva Alegre. Because it would come on after like Zoom.
Yeah.
And then I'd fucking change the channel.
Zoom. That's that's when I turn up the volume. I'm like, oh, finally.
Oh, my people.
On to the main course here. Viva Alegre. You know what
and
that
your
means?
Your dad was like,
oh, and now I'm listening. Do you know what Villa Alegre means?
It means large alligator.
Yep.
Is that right?
That's right.
Oh, okay.
Villa Alegre. Large
what does
alligator.
It mean? What does it mean?
Happy village.
Happy village. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Villa. And would your dad like come into the room and sit down with you when that show was on?
Yeah, we'd watch it together and hold hands.
Okay. Was that whole show in Spanish? I can't remember.
I don't know if it was in Spanish or just people with Spanish accents.
Okay.
And that they pawned that off on the Spanish audience, on the Latin-speaking audience. Like, and here we have here is the chuckle patch with the flowers that tell the jokes. Like, that's not Spanish.
I don't think that's Villa Alegre. I think that's something. You think that's Magic Garden.
That's Magic Garden.
Yeah, it's Magic Garden. Which was bilingual. What, Viva Alegre is bilingual? Okay.
Okay.
So, like, a white guy in the Connecticut suburbs.
A honky like you.
Like me.
Spanish.
Could enjoy the show as well as a gritty New York Latinx.
Now you're getting it, Kev. Now you, after all this time, you finally learned how to speak to me.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Gritty.
All right. So anyway, everyone had their little vanities. We did this thing for Gabe, this Billie Jean thing, which was kind of ridiculous. Well, actually, we'll show it in the, it's in the gag reel. Have you seen the gag reel for this yet?
I have seen the gag reel.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's in the gag reel, but I don't know. We just randomly named the woman who comes to put makeup on for him, Billie Jean, and then all of a sudden started making Billie Jean jokes.
Okay, my friend Billie Jean is a makeup artist. She did a little...
I thought she was your lover.
No, Mickleberry. Billie Jean is not my lover. She's just a girl who happens to be a makeup artist.
Like, you wrote that joke in there, and then... And
well,
you,
I just named her.
You made a couple Billie Jean jokes.
I named her, and then I was like, oh, and then I made some Billie Jean jokes, and then we...
Well, but it's funny
spun
because...
off the rails.
Because we were coming off of our movie Quasi, where we do a Chris DeBerg... don't pay the ferryman joke.
Don't pay the ferryman joke, right.
Here's some money. But a word of caution. Do not pay the ferryman. Don't even fix a price.
Why not?
Do not pay the ferryman till he gets you to the other side.
It's customary to give a bit of an advance on the fare.
Not in this case. In this case, you wait.
What kind of a ferryman is this?
You must go now. Please.
And the test audiences didn't understand the joke at all. We thought it was hilarious.
Christa Berg's song, Don't Pay the Ferryman, from the 80s.
Yeah.
Which we loved.
It was a big
but
hit.
We found out that no one knows what that song is.
Right. Even right. People who grew up in the 80s didn't remember it. Right. And we always talk about it. We're like, well, let's not make these 40-year-old musical references. And all of a sudden, here's Billie Jean. But the case for Billie Jean was it's still Billie Jean. Like,
sure.
That's a really big song.
It's a big song.
And then it started to blow up into Gabe, you know.
Right.
Like, and in fact, like, there's it in the gag reel,
yeah.
Which I have seen plenty of times.
Yeah. We'll show it in a little while.
There's a reference to Smooth Criminal.
Yeah.
Where Gabe says, Eddie, are you okay? Eddie, are you okay? Are you okay, Eddie?
Yeah.
Eddie, are you okay? Are you okay, Eddie?
And then we turn around. We did a couple of them.
Yeah.
And they live now in the gag reel.
So we use them.
But
so
they didn't
go to waste. They didn't go to waste.
We forgot to talk about that. You directed this episode, didn't you?
I did.
Yeah.
Yeah. I directed it. Thanks.
Yeah.
How'd I do?
You did a great job.
Thanks
Lemmy.
A lot. Thanks.
Although
a lot.
You did four, right? You did four and five. Right?
I did,
so you did
Who
this
Gives
one.
A Shift.
Right.
And I did this. This is part of block two.
Right. Okay.
What we like to call the blocks.
Okay.
This is block
and who
two.
Wrote the, Polanski. Jessica Polanski wrote this episode.
Jessica Polanski wrote this episode.
And we stole her name and gave it to Captain Polanski in the show.
In season
because
one.
Because we love the show. But Jessica's great. She wrote on Brooklyn Nine-Nine for a while, and then she came over and wrote with us. She went to Colgate University.
Colgate graduate.
Just like us.
But I will say, this was an episode that I was nervous about. Like, after we shot it, for some reason, I was like, I don't know that I'm loving the episode.
Okay.
And I don't know why, because I love everything about it.
Because vanity makes you uncomfortable.
Well, I think that I was worried that, like, maybe my Botox face was a little too broad.
Okay.
Like, the Dostadning, I love.
People loved that. Botox.
Piece. No, I know. Yeah. And in fact, my kids watched it. It's the episode they've laughed the hardest at.
Yeah, because you look ridiculous.
Yeah, making stupid faces. Yeah.
But let's talk about that.
Let's, Kevin.
Let's talk about Botox face.
Let's talk about Botox
so
face.
The idea was Eddie has a vanity, but doesn't, you know, right at the top of the episode, you say you don't.
Right.
But little do we know you're secretly getting Botox shots.
Right.
For this photo.
Wait, you've never covered up hickeys before.
Because those are no hickeys. Those are Botox bruises.
What? No way.
Yeah, way. I watched 4 seasons of Botox Bunnies on True TV. I know exactly what I'm looking at.
And there's an element of true life to that situation.
Yeah. Should I put a period between every word?
I'd like to stress this situation. Because that's what was happening in real life.
Well,
is that not the case?
Don't you lawyer me, motherfucker. Don't you lawyer
me. Mr. Lemmy, is that not the case?
Is it a yes or no? Is it not the case? The answer is no, that's not the case.
Okay, tell me this Botox story.
What was the case?
Okay.
Was I did get Botox.
Okay.
In the off season.
Okay, what do you mean? Like between shooting Tacoma seasons?
It was two.
You got Botox in your face?
It was two. No, in my shoulder. Yeah, where?
Oh, did it work?
Yeah, it did. Look how smooth it is.
Yeah, okay. Okay. What are you getting mad at me for? You're the Botox guy.
No, because you're prodding me. No. So my wife works at a medical spa.
Okay.
And it's always been a question, you know, like Botox, you want to get some Botox, you want to try it out.
Right.
And I'm like, no, because I require my eyebrows to work.
Sure.
Right? You need to have your eyebrows working. And I'm like, I don't.
Sure. In comedy, you have to be able to move your face.
To make faces. And I don't let, you know, it's like when you see an actor or an actress that like you, their faces are frozen.
Yes. And that's what I get concerned about for you, is that, you know, you see some of these people who just abuse themselves.
Well, so that's the thing. So those are fillers and things like that. Okay, here we go. This is a new feature called Steve Lemmy on Botox and fillers. Okay. So
tutorial.
Well, so I will say Botox has always been the one. That I've said to people, like plastic surgery, I'm not into. Fillers,
sure.
I think people, like you get these duck lips and like people's faces change.
Sure.
But Botox is the one.
But Botox is cool.
But Botox is the one.
Like a fucking drug dealer.
Botox is, hold on a
Let
second.
Let me tell you something about Botox. I mean, everyone says bad things, but it's really good.
No, it is, Kev. Right. Like I have been around people.
Yes.
Like it started, I'm not gonna say, a friend of mine's wife, we were at lunch together and okay. I was like, is there
look fantastic.
Is there something different? It's basically, it's the equivalent of like a mustache. You know, like when you shave your mustache, sometimes people are like, what's different about you? You're like, I don't know. And they're like, something's weird about you. And it's like, oh, you've shaved your mustache. That's Botox.
Okay.
So like I was at lunch with this woman and I was like, what is it that's different about you? And she's like, I don't know. And I was like, honestly, like you look like rested and fantastic. And she was like, I got Botox. And mm-hmm. I was like, holy shit, that's amazing. Like, uh-huh. It's not like the face has changed. It's just glowing.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, now that's a cosmetic procedure I could get behind.
I can get on board with shooting that in my face.
I could do that.
Okay.
But not while I'm shooting because I need my face to move.
Sure, okay.
So we were in the off season. My wife said, do you want to try it? I was like a firefighter, like, nah, I don't know about that, you know? and she's like, you sure? You talk about it all the time. And I'm like, all right, fine, because that's the one I approve of.
So shoot me.
So we went in, and it was funny, because it's like they put line, like, you know, like in the cartoons when they're like the cow, they're like sirloin, and here's the flank.
Sure, the dotted line on the face.
So they're like, you know, what do you want to do with your face? I'm like, oh, I'm already embarrassed.
Yeah.
But
nothing really. I don't even know why I'm here.
Yeah. My dumb wife says I should do it.
I don't know, but what do you think I should do?
Yeah, but I wouldn't mind like taking 10 years off my face. Hey, Blue Chew wants you to have better sex. You, Kevin. Discover your options at BlueChew.com. Chew it and do it.
That's nice, right?
Man, I love that tagline.
We're on a blue couch.
Hey, we got a great deal for our listeners here, okay? You go to BlueChew.com and enter the promo code TALKOMA, TALKOMA.
That's TALKOMA.
And you'll get the first month free, okay? Just all you pay is $5 for shipping and handling.
Whoa, bro.
Yeah, bro. You
free?
Go to free. Wow. Free 99. That's the price.
Isn't it like other places, like, you know, like $10 a pill or something like that?
Yeah.
Isn't it?
You don't want that.
You don't want that?
No.
You get it free.
First month free. Go to BlueChew.com. Enter the promo code TALKOMA, TALKOMA.
That's great.
Get a month free. You know what happens? It's totally discreet. It's online. You answer a few questions. You consult with their licensed medical professionals, and you find out what plan works for you.
And the mailman shows up and makes it rain.
Makes it rain.
You stuff a couple of bills in his G-string, send him on his way.
He'll wonder why you're putting bills in his G-string. He'll wonder as a postman why he's wearing a G-string in the first place, but you know why he is?
Yeah.
Because you now live on Sex Street.
Hey, baby. Maybe that's what you get for your postman, like for Christmas.
Prescription, yeah. Well, what you do is you give your postman says, hey, man, why are you so happy?
Right.
And you say, why? Because I'm the best lover on the planet. He says, why is that? And you say, because I subscribe to BlueChew.com. And so can you,
and
Mr.
Postman.
And then
he does it, and then he just delivers to himself and cuts out the middleman.
Exactly.
Damn.
Like, imagine how happy the postman is when he gets to the post office.
Right.
And he sees there's a package with his name on
it. This one's for me.
Yeah. It's a little tip for himself. Christmas to me.
So go to BlueChew.com, get more details, more information. You get the safety information about it.
Promo code TALKOMA, T-A-L-K-O-M-A.
And thank you, Blue Chew, for sponsoring this podcast.
Hey, folks. Today's episode is brought to you by BetterHelp. Question. What things about yourself are you doing well at that you would like to improve upon in 2024?
Yeah.
What are you already crushing that you can take to the next level? So many times we're saying to ourselves, oh, new year, new you, but that's actually the wrong message.
Right.
Let's not try to like change directions. Let's take things, areas where we're already strong and make them better. It's a form of therapy.
So BetterHelp has people that you talk to about this stuff. 2024, let's make it a better year. Online therapists.
Yeah, if you're thinking about therapy, try BetterHelp. See, BetterHelp is totally online. It's convenient. It's designed to be flexible so it can fit your schedule. And what you do is you go to betterhelp.com/promo code TALKOMA, T-A-L-K-O-M-A, and you'll answer a brief questionnaire and they'll link you up with a licensed therapist. And if you ever want to switch therapists, you can do that too.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
All right, so celebrate the progress you've already made, 2024, right?
Yep.
So go to betterhelp.com/TALKOMA, T-A-L-K-O-M-A. And if you do that, you get 10% off the first month. So betterhelp.com, that's HELP.com/TALKOMA, T-A-L-K-O-M-A, right?
Sounds awesome.
Start improving yourself.
Let's have a great 2024.
Hey, buongiorno, chi fai? Okay, I have only been studying Italian for 1 minute, and I already know how to say hi. What's going on in Italian? Okay, if you want to learn another language, the best way to do that is immersion, living in a place where the language is spoken. But since nobody really gets to do that, the second best way to do it is with Babbel. That's the sound of learning right now. That's one of my favorite sounds. Here it is again. That's the sound of learning with Babbel. So I don't know if you know this, but 1 in 5 people has learning a new language in 24 on their bucket list, okay? And if you want to learn a new language, then for just 10 minutes a day, Babbel will have you speaking that new language in just 3 weeks, conversationally, practically, saying, hi, how are you? My name is Steve. Where's the restaurant? Where's the bathroom? Where's the office of the president? Any of those things. How much does this cost? Practical stuff, everyday stuff, so you can communicate without using one of those clumsy apps. Now, if Babbel can have you be doing this in 3 weeks, imagine what you can be doing in a whole year when you learn with Babbel. There's that sound again. Okay, so we have a deal for our listeners, okay? So our listeners will get 55% off. It's a limited time. 55% off of your Babbel subscription, but only for our listeners by going to babbel.com/TALKOMA. Okay, so that's 55% off your subscription by going to Babbel, BABBEL.com/TALKOMA, T-A-L-K-O-M-A, okay? Studies have shown that 15 hours on Babbel is equivalent to an entire semester of college. What does that say about our learning institutions? They are not as good as Babbel. 15 hours on Babbel will have you learning a new language, okay? And if you want that live classroom feel, you can actually go to Babbel and they have live classes as well with professors 7 days a week. So it's up to you. 10 minutes a day with yourself or however long you want with the live class. So go to babbel.com/TALKOMA, 55% off your subscription, and you will be speaking Italian or Spanish or Chinese or Japanese or Swedish or any other language you so desire to speak. Okay, ciao. That means goodbye. So, but you know, she's like, what do you think? I was like, well, you know, like the lines up here, and to be totally transparent, I was like, if you could make it so my forehead could be flat, but I can still use my eyebrows, like that would be ideal, because then I could get away with this. And she's like, what about the eyes? I'm like, not the eyes.
What do you mean get away with it? What do you mean?
Meaning I could do it on film.
Okay.
You know, my all eyebrows right. could
Nobody
move.
Nobody would know.
And my forehead would be nice and smooth. But so anyway, so eventually you get your face is all marked up, and I just went with the Botox. She's like, so you want your eyebrows moved? She's like, that's right up here. And I was like, fine, let's do it.
Yeah.
And so she's like, okay, that feels like about 10 cc's or something. That's an arbitrary number. And so I did it. And, you know, it's like it takes a few days to like sort of like to vet.
Okay.
Or to vest, what would it be? Like, I don't know.
I don't even know.
To stick. I mean, we deal with it.
Yeah, in the show.
By the way, watching the show, my wife was like, she saw the thing and she was like, oh, that's duh. like you know, in like Highlander, it's like, oh, it's the quickening.
Yeah.
Like she had a term for that. I got to find out what that is. She had a term for it.
Okay.
She was like,
the hardening.
It might be the hardening.
Oh, that's the hardening.
Yeah. When my face gets stuck, like she called it out. The hardening. Because she's from Miami. That's how she speaks. Okay. But so, okay. So,
so you had it done.
So I had it done. I went back.
Covertly.
And then I was like, my eyebrows could move, but I was like, but there was still some wrinkle going. I was like, because you can always go back in.
Sure. Always.
I was like, let's go back.
Yeah. Hit the lips this time.
I went in. I was like, I need some more CCs. She's like, you want the full package? God. I was like, give me the CCs.
Oh, my God.
And so she blasted my forehead.
Okay.
And then you go, and like, you have to lay down on your back.
Where was I during this time
period? So God. Tiffany was like, you going to tell Kevin? I was like, yeah. But, because I'm not, because, like, I know it sounds vain, but I'm not a vain person. Like, this is like I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed.
Sure.
Like, I'm planning on telling you, but I want to wait for the right time. I'm not going to call you up and be like, I got Botox today.
But you didn't tell me, though, ever.
Because the right time didn't present itself.
Okay. All right.
And so, like, actually, like, I had a July 4th get-together, and Heather Mazur came over, and she was—
Who plays my wife, Vicky, in the show.
Who plays your wife, Vicky, and my sister.
Yeah.
And Heather, one of the nice things about Heather is, like, unlike you— Is that here comes the attack? Is that like when you I'm not going to. Is when you have a party, like Heather's one of the first to arrive.
Right.
Like she and her husband are always one of the first people to arrive. They come in, and so you get a lot of, you know, private time with Heather, and and she's like, what's going on? What have you been doing? And she was like, how are you spending your days during the off season? I was like, I'll tell you what, I got Botox. She was like, what? And like she's actually the only person I ever told. She's like, are you going to tell Kevin? I'm like, I'm going to tell Kevin at the right time. And she's like, what's the right time? I'm like, you know, it's got to be like, he's got to be making fun of it, or like something's going to be happening. Like the time's got to be right for me to lay it on him. And then the thing is that time never materialized.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a little bullshit, but okay.
Okay. That's fine for you to think.
I mean, you know, because there's a reason why you didn't tell me.
No, I wanted to tell you.
Okay.
I want to tell you. And and ultimately it's—
Because you knew I'd give you shit for it.
I want your shit. I want you to give me shit. I love, you know, like exchanging shit. It's like for me, it's like a cat sharpening its claws on the scratching post. I want that.
But think about how many times you could have just out of the blue said, I got Botox.
Hey, Kev, confession. I got Botox.
You did what? You got the Botox.
I didn't.
Your face is pumped so full of filler, you can't emote.
Fine, I admit it. I did do the Botox.
Okay, well, anyway.
Okay, so?
So when we were in the writer's room, and I don't know if like that begot the idea.
I think so, right?
So, or no? I mean, it was on our list, but like it might have been because, you know, but like I made my confession there in front of everyone in the room, and you were flabbergasted. But that's, by the way, the right time to make the confession.
I guess so.
Yeah.
I guess so.
And I did wait for the right time.
And let me ask this question.
Okay, I'll let you.
How many more times have you had it?
No, that's the only time.
No, you fucking lie to me.
That's the only time.
Don't you lie to me.
That's the only time, but I'm considering it again.
How come?
I'm considering,
I don't know. You look great.
Thanks, Kev.
I don't know. You know, I don't think you need it unless you've been doing it and not telling me.
No, I haven't. I haven't. So my wife made fun of us relentlessly after the episode. She was like, you motherfuckers don't even know the difference between Botox and fillers. And I was like, what?
She's right.
It was the point when, like, at the end when you start pushing my face, you're so full up with fillers. Like, that's not what I got.
Sure.
I got Botox up here.
Sure. But Terry McConkie doesn't know either.
That's true. Fuck, I should have said that to her.
Terry McConkie doesn't know.
Terry doesn't know.
Okay.
Anyway, so.
Well, that's another wonderful kind of real life thing that we put into the show. And then I think then it became this idea, which, yes, and it was hard for you as a director, is to figure out how far we go with these faces. And then you had to hold those faces as if your face was frozen the whole time.
Yeah. So the thing, like, we present three faces here.
Yeah.
there's first a smug face, like,
yeah,
right. And like, and the thing, like, you know, I have found something out about you over the last year. You're a cruel director. Like,
I wasn't directing this episode.
I know I was, but like, you were like, it'd be time for me to do smug face, and I'd be like this, and you're like, smugger, and I'd be like, and you'd be like, smugger, and you, my face couldn't get more smug.
It could.
I couldn't.
And the smuggest looks are the ones we used in the cut.
That's, those are the ones where my left eye's closed.
Yeah, yeah. That's like a Popeye look.
Yeah, that's just, that's not even smug face ever. That's just stupid face. And then, so we did smug face.
Yeah.
And then we had dead face.
Yeah. Which is just a flat face, right? Yeah. And then we had fucking defib face.
Yeah, shocked face.
Yeah. Which is also a funny, funny moment that, that stunt, we got a stunt guy. We put him on a ratchet,
mm-hmm.
and then we shocked your face and pulled that stunt guy back into the
yeah. Into well, the and wall. It's the many uses, but we found that out too. Writing the episode is that those things can cure temporary muscular paralysis.
Sure,
electricity can.
Sure, I bet there are, you know, probably a lot of people calling bullshit on that moment, but
that's fine.
Fuck them.
Listen, this isn't a science podcast.
Nah,
we don't do science. This is comedy around here. Yeah,
and when you get shocked, it's funny.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. And we don't know from Botox or fillers. Like, just, you know what?
Apparently you do.
It's like in Austin Powers 2, where they start to get into the whole time travel thing, and why don't you just go back in time? And then they're like, you know, let's not worry too much about that. Right? We don't worry about this stuff.
It's true.
I'm looking at the camera a lot today.
That's good. Play to it, right?
Yeah.
Speaking of old age for me, though, that other thing, the plot about me, we did this Dostadning thing.
I'm sorry, Kevin, what?
Dostadning.
Thank you. Can we say it properly?
But it started out, part of it was just feeling old because when we were writing this episode, I had pulled a muscle in my shoulder, like the rhomboid muscle or something like that, like the muscle that connects your shoulder to your arm.
Yeah.
And it was a super painful thing.
It wasn't like one of your legs numb or something like
I
that?
I don't know. The whole, everything went fucking downhill. And so, I would be sitting in the writer's room and like, you can't let your arm just hang because it's painful.
Yeah.
But I would sit in the writer's room like this, the whole writer's room, like hours in the day, I'd just be sitting like this because it'd be so fucking painful, you know? But it was a lot of this and everyone thought it was hysterical, but I was in pain.
Yeah.
Everyone thought it was fucking hysterical and they wrote it into the episode.
Oh boy.
What's wrong with your shoulder?
I tweaked it pulling up my comforter.
What do you have, like a weighted blanket or something?
No, it's just high-quality comforter.
It's time to switch to the lightweight summer comforter.
I don't know. I like to sweat.
If I had a dime.
Listen, we're, you know, as TV writers, you're trying to come up with a lot of
episode
ideas.
Sure, you
got
to put all the shit in you can.
Yeah.
So now Terry's got to, Terry did the same thing, pulling up his comforter. Here it is.
Right. Well, that's something that, I mean, you know, I hate to turn this into the old guy podcast, yeah. But that was something that happened to me. I bent down to pull up my comforter one time, and, yeah. And it was like, oh! You know, and that's that can happen at any age, though.
It can. But that's why we wanted to put it into this thing. That's where this Dostadning thing came from.
Dostadning.
Which is a Swedish thing. You talk about what Dostadning is because it came from you, right? Didn't you come up with this idea?
Pelletieri. Mike Pelletieri.
Oh, he did? Okay.
Who's one of our writers who always comes up with delightful, obscure ideas. But Dostadning is the idea of decluttering your brain.
Right. But it's a Swedish thing and it's a Swedish word.
Yeah. And it's
death cleaning.
Yeah, and it's right? for when you're older, like, and you're feeling the stress when you have like random pains and things like that. Like, it's a philosophy that you are carrying a lot of mental burdens.
Right. Okay.
You need to de-burden yourself, whether that is something like, I have all these tchotchkes on my shelves,
sure.
And I don't like them, but they're gifts from people.
Right.
Just get rid of it.
Right.
Who cares? Or there's like a secret that you've got. That you've been meaning to tell somebody, like you got Botox.
Right.
And
we did them all. Like the tchotchke thing was the wing pillow.
Correct.
You gave me a pillow of you eating wings.
Right.
Which actually was a great pillow.
Sit on this.
Yeah. Great pillow.
Excellent pillow.
And there were like multiples of them.
There were at least.
Do you have one still?
So I still have one. There were three that were made. Someone stole one from my house.
Really? Stole from your house?
Out of my office.
Like at a party or something? Or
I don't know. Like, but like one went missing.
Have you checked like eBay? Maybe somebody's selling on eBay.
I should. Although I would hope that would just be a collector's item. But you know, if it's on eBay, I'm going to buy it and see who it comes from.
Okay. And catch him in the act? It's
probably your brother.
You think he stole it?
Yeah, I bet Pat stole it.
Maybe.
And then one was like, I don't want to say this
to you, Kev. But this happens. This happens. One was there was a Searchlight employee.
Yeah.
Who no longer works there.
Yeah.
But she was a big Broken Lizard fan.
Right.
And one of our friend's wives, who was at my house.
Yeah.
Said she was hoping for some, like a souvenir. Now she's not working at the company anymore.
A tchotchke.
A souvenir of some kind.
Yeah.
And maybe was hoping you would sign it. And I said, why me? And she said, because you're her favorite.
Ooh, okay.
That happens. Kevin's everybody's favorite.
Unlikely.
Kevin's everybody's favorite. So I was like, what? I mean, it was on the spot. And I was like, oh, the sit on this chicken wing pillow. And so I autographed it and sent it on its way.
Okay.
And now I have one left. And when it showed up in the Death Photos episode, my kids went wild because they've been staring at that cushion for a year and a half.
It gets a good laugh.
Yeah.
And then the other one we did was the story that I tell Lucy about her birth and why I've held her birth against her.
Yes.
And it was that she cost me tickets to a Mariners game
yeah.
the night she had she was born.
She got born.
Well, in 1998, Ken Griffey Jr. led the American League with 55 home runs. On September 25th, he was going for a career high 56. And I had the tickets.
Oh.
But unexpectedly, Vicky went into labor with you, and I had to give up those tickets. That night, when I was in the hospital, Ken Griffey Jr. hit his 56th home run, and because of your birth, I missed it.
Also a true story. Comes from a true story for me,
yeah.
for the birth of my first child.
Tell that story, Kev.
Which, you know, I tell this story every year on my daughter's birthday to remind her of the pain that she caused me with her birth.
When she gets married, you're probably yeah. gonna tell a story too,
yeah.
and you're gonna cry.
We were watching the episode, and when I started telling this Mariner story as Terry McConkie, my wife gasped. But the true story was that my wife was pregnant, and she had high blood pressure. Her blood pressure went up from the pregnancy, and so they had to induce the birth a little bit early, like about 3 weeks early. And it just so happens that I had tickets to Monday Night Football, and it was the Dallas Cowboys against the New York Giants.
Uh-huh.
Which is, you know, I'm a Giant, a big Giants fan.
Right.
And that particular game, that season, the Dallas Cowboys had hired Bill Parcells as their head coach.
The former coach of the New York Giants?
The legendary coach of the New York Giants.
The Tuna?
The greatest NFL football coach ever. And they hired him to be the Dallas Cowboys coach, and he was coming back to Giants Stadium for the first time to play the Giants in Giants Stadium.
Now, this is the Cowboys are one of the Giants' biggest rivals.
Hated Cowboys.
Yeah.
So anyway, I had tickets to the game.
Excellent.
Very excited. And so that afternoon, I went to an appointment with my wife at her gynecologist, and they were, you know, examining her, and the doctor looked at her and said, you know what, we got to do this right now. We got to get the baby. You have to have the baby because your blood pressure is going too high. And she said, why don't you come in tonight and let's get going? And I was like, could we do it tomorrow?
You heartless bastard.
And they both looked at me like I was fucking crazy. And they're like, what are you talking about? I was like, I have tickets to the Monday Night Football game. I mean, and if it's like a thing, can't we just do it tomorrow? And they're like, absolutely furious. My wife was furious at me. So I was like, all right, fuck it. Okay, fine. Okay. And so I gave the tickets away to my brother. It hurt, but I gave him the tickets. So I said, you know what? I'll just watch the game at home. And then at like 11 o'clock at night, we have to go in and start the process. Okay. So I'm watching the game on the couch in my apartment. And my wife's getting ready to go to the hospital to give birth to our first child. And
it's a big moment.
Big moment. And the game goes into overtime.
Uh-oh.
And I said, can we just give me like 20 minutes, you know? And she's like, you know, furious. And then I look up and she's standing at the door, coat on with her bag. And she said, I'm going. I was like, oh, fuck. And so I was like, it's an overtime. Can't we just, no. Okay. So I said, okay. So I go.
When you look up and she's standing in the doorway with her bag on her shoulder and yeah. her coat. How long did it take for you to get your ass off the fucking?
I was trying to say, hey, you know, this is not like
work with me.
Yeah, this work is not like we're here. Catching a train here. You know, maybe we're gonna miss a train. We got a little flexibility here, right? I mean, come on, don't we?
Wiggle room.
Yeah. And no, she wanted nothing to do this. Okay, so we go out, we get in the cab, because we're living in New York City at the time. We're driving across town to get to the hospital, and my phone rings. And I look at it, it's my brother. And I'm like, ah, fuck. And I pick up the phone, and he goes, are you watching this game? It's unbelievable. And I'm like, ah, I am in a cab on my way to the hospital. I have no idea what's going on. He's, it's amazing. And I can hear the crowd roaring. And I was like, hopefully maybe I can get to the hospital and watch the thing. It's the most unbelievable game. I hung up on him, and that was it. And then we got to the hospital, and there were no tell. I couldn't see the game at all. But I don't know. I think the Giants won. I can't even remember. It was an overtime game.
You blocked it out.
Yeah, it was an amazing game. And my daughter was born the next morning, happy and healthy.
That's what's important.
Yeah.
And your wife also?
And my wife, happy and healthy. But to this day, I remind them of that story.
As well,
that
you should.
Every year, I remind them that on her birthday, she cost me the experience of going to that game.
And by she, it's either of them.
Well, both of them.
You should sit them down together.
That's true. It's true.
By she, I mean both of them.
It's true.
Those women. And the female gynecologist who's like, you know, she doesn't know football.
It's Bill Parcells. Coming back as a Cowboys coach.
Tuna.
So anyway, my kids love that story. My wife likes it now. She didn't like it then.
Yeah.
And so whatever, we decided we would write it into this episode.
And
we had to switch it because we live in Tacoma. So it was now Ken Griffey hitting a home run in the Mariners game.
Right. Now, in the episode, you know, Lucy's like, well, I think you did the right thing. And, you know, and Terry's like, ooh, that feels good to get off my chest and just walks away.
Yeah.
He still remains oblivious. Are you oblivious or do you think you were wronged?
I don't think I was wronged. I think it was unfortunate circumstances.
Did you do the right thing?
I absolutely did the right thing.
How come you can't look me in the eye?
Well, I still feel like there was wiggle room. Like, I could have sat there for another 10 minutes and watched the end of the football game, but I was guilted into not. And so, you know.
Oh, boy. Let me mark this episode down. I'm definitely going to get your wife to watch this episode.
Well, she's heard. I mean, she's heard it all. I mean, she's lived this thing for 20 years now. My daughter's 20 now. I mean, you know.
It's funny. The part that my kids also laughed out loud at. By the way, I've discovered this season you're a good actor, Kevin. Mm.
Thank you.
My wife and children have been laughing at your performances.
Oh, thank you.
And one thing
I always feel like I'm just yelling. I'm always yelling at everybody on the set.
But in this episode, you said, you know, it's the part where you're like,
Vicky and I have decided that in the event that something should happen to us, we would be honored if you would be the guardian of our daughters.
And everybody laughed out loud at that.
Sure. A little bit of emotion. Faux motion.
Yeah, faux motion. That's our specialty.
You were talking about a Dostadning thing that you were thinking about doing a Dostadning now.
I feel like you and I should have like
a Dostadning.
Yeah, a Dostadning.
That's Swedish, guys.
Yeah. By the way, Swedish is such a great language. It's such a great language. Like Dostadning. I mean, that one is one of the few words in Swedish that
you can't tell what it really means.
Yeah, you're like, oh, I don't
death know. Clean, yeah. Cleaning, cleansing, whatever it is.
But like Sweden, like, you know, I've spent my fair share of time in,
I bet you
in
have.
Sweden, you know what I'm saying? And it's basically English. No, seriously. Hand, armut, foot. That's how you say those things in Swedish.
And there are good ones, though, too. What's a...
Okay, so there's
the jacuzzi or whatever?
Well, so jacuzzi, this is a great one. Is boobel pool. That's how you say it. I'm not kidding. It's bubble pool. Booble pool.
Okay.
And if you say that to a Swedish person, like, it's not booble pool, it's booble pool. The very particular, there's an ice hockey stick is ice hockey club. So ice hockey club instead of ice hockey stick.
Okay.
There's a wheelchair.
Yeah.
Roll stool. Doggy style. Doggy style is a great one. That's a hund stil.
Doggy style?
Yeah, hound style.
Hound style.
Yeah, hund stil.
Okay. Hund stil.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you want to, we might bleep this one out, but do you want to know how to say suck my dick in Swedish?
Sure.
Slicka mein kuk. Slick my kuk.
Slicken my kuk?
Slicken mein kuk.
Okay.
That's how you say suck.
You're
my
making
dick.
It up now.
No, that's real.
Really?
That's real.
Okay.
Here's earthquake.
Okay.
Ground shaking. Okay, that one I made up. That one I made up. But Sleek of Mine Cook is...
You could have sold that to me. Real. I would have bought
you
that.
You know what I could have? I wanted to say that to you with a wink so you knew that I was...
Sure.
Yeah. But no, a dose dodding, a death cleanse. I have something that like... I felt guilty about it at the time.
Yeah.
But it was okay.
Yeah.
And so I didn't mention anything.
Okay.
And then like over the years... Like there's a landmark event that you have, and over the years
I have.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's something that happened at a Memorial Day barbecue, probably like 6 or 7 years ago. I felt very badly about.
Okay.
And every time you've had a Memorial Day barbecue, I come to it. I'm like, oh man, it's like a Botox thing. I'm like, I should tell Kevin about this. I should.
Something you did?
Something I did, and I always feel I feel this guilt about it.
Okay.
And because it involves one of your children.
Oh, Jesus. Okay.
And I'm like, today's the good time to get this off my chest.
Okay.
Because really, it's just going to, like, I'm not going to have to think about it anymore.
Right. Okay.
Okay. So.
Now I have to think about it.
So 1 year, I got out of the pool and I had to pee.
Yeah.
And I went into your house, towel around my waist. And I went down the stairs and I peed and I came back. And you have, like, ceramic tiles.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then I was there, like, picking at some of the food in the kitchen.
Yeah.
And your middle daughter, Quinny.
Yeah.
Walked in.
Yeah.
And she was she turned the corner a little quickly and she slipped and wiped out and like fell on her hip.
Yeah.
And she was like, ow, and got up. She was like, ah, and then like kind of like walked away. She shook it off.
Okay.
And I was like,
okay.
And then I was like, oh.
Okay.
I like wiped down the floor and I was like,
I see. Cause she slipped on your.
She slipped on my drips.
On your wet.
She slipped. It was definitely. I didn't realize I had done it, but she. Had,
okay.
I was like, she has slipped on my wet.
Sure. Okay.
And I did that. And I was like, and thankfully she was okay.
Right.
And then like she went to bed and she came back and she was fine and everything. Like
she
that.
Didn't know.
She didn't know. I mean, she didn't know, you know, for better or for worse.
Right.
But then she went outside and I was like,
and I can imagine she like cracked her head open and get stitches.
God, I definitely wouldn't have told you. Definitely wouldn't have told you.
But that's the other thing we were talking about, people falling down. It's like kids who fall down, they're just made out of rubber now.
Yeah, it didn't hurt. I mean, but she slipped and she was like, ow. And then like got up and was like, and like looked at the floor and like looked at the wetness. I was like, that's my wet.
Oh, Jesus.
And I was sitting there like with my, you know, holding a wing. And then feeling bad, I was like, what's she going to come out when she comes out of the bath? Is she going to be limping?
Okay.
What if she goes to the emergency room or something like that? But then like every Memorial Day when I'm there, and often sometimes on Thanksgiving.
Make sure you're dry.
When I'm there, I definitely dry off a lot. But I also laugh. I also chuckle to myself. I see the area and I'm like, man, I'm the.
I should ask her if she remembers that.
Because I don't even think I've told my wife.
Okay.
That's when I've been holding on to by myself.
Okay.
And I've just dosed-oddened.
Okay.
And I feel,
how do you feel?
Fucking great. I feel great. Whew.
Okay.
I got that off my chest. Whew. Do you have a dosedodning for me?
I don't.
You don't have anything that you want to come clean about?
I brought my...
I've got one for you.
I brought my picture, my little picture.
Nah, I've got one for you.
Oh, shit. Uh-oh. Okay.
I've got one for you.
Yeah.
You already kind of dosedodninged me, actually, already about this one.
I did.
But it was when we were doing live shows in San Diego.
Yeah.
And I went for a jog along the bay.
Yeah.
And I called you up.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I was like, Kev, they've got like paddle boats for rent, rowboats for rent. Like, we have 8 hours before our show. Do you want to rent a boat and just like let's go like sail around together? It's fucking gorgeous day out here. And you're like, not interested. And fucking hung up on me. I was like, holy fucking shit.
And
like a day.
I just wanted to go for a boat ride.
It was just a boat ride. And a day or two later, you actually came to me and you were like, you know, Steve, I'm sorry. You were trying to offer me something beautiful in my life and I shat on your idea.
Right. Well, I feel bad about that because, it's like we were on the road a lot and you end up like spending like Saturday afternoon just dicking around your hotel and you were trying to do something, you know, different and productive.
Get you out of the hotel room.
Yeah, and it was a very noble endeavor and I shit on it.
You did. You shat on it and you offered a...
And I don't know that it would be any different like a week from now. But.
No, and we've talked about it. Like maybe you and I should, like Terry and Eddie, buy a boat together. In real life, I've said if I ever like win the lottery or something, I'm going to buy you a boat, and it's going to be called the Not Interested, and it's K-N-O-T, because you got to have a nautical
K-N-O-T.
A nautical
That's
pun.
Absolutely right. That's
not
right.
Interested.
Okay.
Yeah, you'll never go out on that thing.
One of the other ones we had a dosedodding with Granny's puppet,
mm-hmm.
but it was a deleted scene.
Let's show it.
You want to do a deleted scene?
Let's do a deleted scene.
Deleted scene!
Granny! I have a confession to make to you two.
Okay.
One of your puppets did not actually perish in that station fire.
Who?
Sir Winky.
Winky's alive?
Yeah! I spilled my coffee one day, and I didn't have any paper towels, so Sir Winky helped me clean it up.
Wait, how?
On the end of a mop. His felt's really absorbent. With a little spit, that guy could clean anything. So I'm giving him back to you. Hey, Sir Winky, here he is. His eye's a little whack, but there's nothing a little needle and thread can't fix.
What the hell?
Huh? Here.
Oh, God. Oh.
Happy reunion, guys. Mickleberry, I don't know you very well, and I didn't want to hire you in the first place. But you're here because you have a silly name. Ndostad Ning feels great.
Doesn't feel so great to me.
The Swedes were really onto something. I should get a Volvo.
So yeah, that just got, it got a little long, you know, with the, there were a little too many Dostadnings there.
It got long.
And then, I don't know, I felt like we were dwelling too much on puppets for some reason this season.
Yeah. But sometimes you have to make cuts based on just the episode length. And that, like, in case anyone's wondering where it goes, it's right after Terry has made the Dostadning to
Lucy.
Lucy, he turns and you can
see me kind of walk there, but we just cut out of the scene
there. We cut it. But it's a good scene.
It's a good scene. It's a funny scene.
Yeah.
With his, and it introduced a new puppet.
It did.
I like that too.
Yeah.
You want to see the gag reel?
What do you mean, do I want to see the gag reel?
The gag reel is good stuff.
Of course I want to see the gag reel.
You want to watch it?
What?
Showing some boobs. Jeez,
guys.
Take your shirt off.
Pull your fucking shirt down!
So aggressive.
Scream at him like that. Show some respect.
Yeah. Triple Chin Jafe, guys. That's his name, right? You guys don't want to say that? Okay, great. That's fine. I get it.
God rest his soul.
Sorry.
You want to go?
No. I want you to go.
I thought it was...
Nope.
God rest his soul.
Hold on.
Son of a bitch.
You died saving a school bus
start
full of
kids. Start with the, like, the laughing that you did.
Like that kind of thing?
Yeah.
Captain Boris Chafee. Maybe you should do your hair. Your mother got you that nice blower for Easter. Your mom got you that really nice blow dryer online.
What are you doing?
Whoa.
Here, let me do that again. That's terrible. Fuck.
You've done better.
Sorry. I'm catching my last big
How have you not worked this out?
That was his best entrance I've ever seen.
Back to one. Dave, I'm so sorry, Gabe.
So sorry, Mr. Hogan.
I'm so sorry.
My daughter's here, man. She's probably watching this.
Well, you were right about that, Granny.
Yeah.
Have you ever been late?
You know, it was a time, and it was like an over-the-pants type of thing, and it was just super complicated, and... I just...
Don't you dare cut.
There's time, Mickleberry. There's time.
No, Mickleberry. Billie Jean is not my lover. She's just a girl who is a makeup artist.
Does it look bad? Like, bad? Like, really, really bad?
Ah, beat it, Mickleberry. Seriously, just beat it.
Eddie, are you okay? Are you okay, Eddie?
Granny, if you're talking about my baby, don't matter if you're black or white, man.
And cut.
So that was a string of all the Michael Jackson things.
That was.
Or, you know, a bunch of them. And, I mean, we went off the deep end. And there's, you know, there's more than that, but those are the best ones.
No, they're great. We beat that joke into the ground.
Yeah, we did.
Our good friend Bill Paxton used to say, we beat it purple.
One of the clips I like of that also is when, you know, we have a very kind of collegial, friendly family set.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone's always just yelling shit from off camera. Like, that gag girl starts with, like, everyone off camera yelling at you to pull your shirt down. There's got like 10 people.
And the main voice is your brother.
Is my brother, right. He's the grip.
Yeah.
He's telling you to pull your fucking shirt
like
down.
Like on a real set? Because I'm only the creator of the show.
You're only the showrunner.
The employer.
The star of the show.
Yeah. On a real set?
Yeah.
I would fire that motherfucker on the spot. But?
Or make him take his shirt off and work without a shirt on for the day.
But my hands are tied. He's your brother.
I got it, yeah.
So we got to treat him nice.
Anyway, that's the gag rail. I love the gag rails, God. I love them.
Mm. Wait, do you not have a Dostadnik for me?
I don't, really.
You know, this is going to be interesting, because I told you yesterday we should do Dostadniks for each other, and I came up with one. You didn't.
I know, but I was stuck. I thought you meant like, hey, you know, get rid of this thing or whatever. You know what I mean? I didn't know you meant deep-seated emotional sharing. I mean, I'm not good at that.
I know you're not. I know you're not. That's why I wanted you to do one. Here's your assignment.
Okay, next time.
For the next episode.
Okay, let me write it down.
You come up with a Dostadnik.
Okay, I will do that. Okay. Yes. For the next episode.
Yeah. Next episode.
I probably won't. I probably won't.
No, he will. He
will. At some point, I will.
He will.
All right.
All right,
that's it. Let's wrap this up, man.
Please.
I think we're going too long.
For fuck's sake.
God. I mean, like, Alex can't even stay awake out there.
Yeah.
He's so fucking bored.
All right, guys. Right. Hey, thanks for tuning in to another episode of Talk Home at FD. Tune in for next week's episode, Valentine's Day, when our guest is Heather Mazur.
Ooh. Vicky Panizzi McConkey, huh?
Panizzi.
She's going to join us. All right, awesome. Yeah. All right, thanks, everybody. We'll see you.